I'm just going to get us off to the races, and we're going to turn it over to you for most of the time. To kick things off with, a lot of people out here are fans of Doctor Who, going back to childhood, like Peter. Pearl, I wonder what you were a super fan of when you were a kid. Was it cartoons? Was it movies?
What was I super fan of when I was a kid? I really liked Judy Garland. It was very cool when I was a kid. I also really liked Buffy the Vampire Slayer. Place the crowd, that's obviously what I meant. Yeah, no, I was a big Buffy fan. I had like the books and stuff.
I mean, Judy Garland's really cool.
I think Judy Garland's really cool.
Yeah, she's great. I have all the action figures.
All the Judy's. Every single version of Mimi in St. Louis. I would buy that, to be fair.
It's just that I could draw, that's all. So I just like to draw, and then you start to people say, look at this drawing, look at this picture, and I'm not particularly scholarly about it, it's just a lot of painters that I love, but that just comes out of, you know, you're allowed to do that, everybody's allowed to love them. You make me sound very grand. You're talking about Buffy the Vampire Slayer, and Judy Garland, and I'm talking about Leonardo da Vinci. And,
all right, fine, well, let's talk about another fan favorite, franchise that you're part of, Paddington Bear. One of the highlights for me.
Paddington Bear.
Yeah. Please look after that bear over there. I'm assuming that you were a fan of Paddington going into being a part of the first movie.
Yes, I wrote to Paddington when I was very young. So if there was any chance that I might also be in a Paddington series of films.
Did you write that?
Paddington is kind of a national institution.
Yeah. I mean, we all sort of grew up with Paddington. So yeah, he's a great comfort, a great series. He used to be on TV, it was a delight to be. That was the job I did just before I became Doctor Who, and it was great. Those films, I think, are so sincere, and so well-meaning, and so beautifully made. And I think. When you make a film like that, which costs millions of dollars and has to make millions of dollars back to make money, for that sincerity to survive at the heart of it is very rare. And so I put that down to the director, who did a brilliant, brilliant job.
Now, I know that a lot of people will ask things like, you know, what your favorite episode to work on was, your favorite set to work on, that sort of thing. I'm curious about props. Favorite props to play with on the set. Does it come down to the sonic sunglasses for you, Peter? Is it the levers and dials and all of that inside the TARDIS? Was there anything that you got to play with on the set? Because having a prop as an actor gives you a little bit of business to do, gives you something to occupy yourself with.
Well, I think we should pass this over to you. But before I do, I just want to say that Doctor Who doesn't have very much money. Yeah. I don't mean just him personally, but the show. So the props fall to pieces, so you can't really play with them too much. And often, you know, someone would come in with a ray gun and go like that, and then the ray gun would fall to pieces. So you spend most of your time trying to hold the props together. So it was very difficult to have a favorite, wasn't it?
Yeah,
when
they
fall to pieces.
They weren't very comprehensive.
No, but we had 2 million props guys, Liam and Matt, who were just fantastic, looked after us, and they had the miserable job of gluing the ray guns back together.
I really enjoyed the vault, the door to the vault. Oh, yeah. Which was the thing that you had to press all the four buttons and do the things, and then it was Matt who had to like make sure it opened, but it would sort of fall a bit like that. It's meant to be like metal, and it was made of
wood
and cardboard.
I used to love seeing the difference between what was written in the script and what was there on the set. Because if you can face the Raven, there's a control panel which in the script was designed as having, the Doctor had a key which he had to insert into the key, and he turned it a quarter and it would click, and then he turned it another quarter and it would double click, and then he had to turn it 3 quarters back and it would be a big hum and it would open up, and I got it and I said, where is it? They pointed to a hole. And they said, it's in there. And you just got to stick your hand in and act all that.
I've just got one more little one for you, and then we've got quite the line. This is magnificent. You followed instructions so well, all of you lovely folks. During your run as the doctor, we got a very distinctly Buckaroo Banzai, like a little kind of mise-en-scene at one point. I wonder, was that from Stephen being a big fan of Buckaroo Banzai? Was it maybe a little bit of something that you enjoy or something?
I'm sorry, I don't know what you're talking about.
the guitar and the sunglasses, and no matter where you go, there you are. Was that something that Stephen even went over with you? You weren't even aware of it?
But what is Buckaroo Banzai? Buckaroo Banzai,
it's a Peter Weller film from 1984 that seven of us here little references like that, okay. that Stephen would put into the scripts, was it something you'd be aware of, or was it like this, where obviously it was not discussed with you?
I'd generally be no idea. I would just show up and I didn't, you know, he's very, very clever. And that, I just sort of said to them, I think it would be fun if the doctor could play the guitar, but I didn't really expect them to go with it. I said he should just play it like a teenager. He should be in his room, you know, playing these terrible, you know, power chords and plugging to the TARDIS control console and making a guitar and all that. And the next thing I read, they said, there's the scene of him coming in on a tank. And of course, I said, that doesn't work. I said, that's not any good. That's like a Share video. Without Share. Which can only be disappointing. But yeah, no, I would imagine he probably did put those references in. We shall ask him next time.
Was there anything in particular on set that you enjoyed, whether it was a reference, whether it was a particular time that you guys went back to, Earl?
I think my favorite set was probably the set for Thin Ice, the Westminster Bridge. I remember Michael showing me that and just being totally blown away, like before we sort of started filming on that, and just being like so. Overall, I mean, it was about the height of the ceiling. It was genuinely massive. Because I mean, some of the sets are, some of them are huge, and some of them are like just tiny portions of it, and then it's like the rest of it is a bit of CGI or something like that. But with this one, I was genuinely like, this is actually quite amazing. It was quite a humbling experience. I remember being like, literally felt quite dwarfed by all the show and sort of everything. Kind of, it sort of, I think that was for me kind of. Sort of the first moment it hit me, sort of how big it all was. Literally and metaphorically.
I can just say that Michael Pickwood, who was our designer, who passed away about 2 weeks ago, was responsible for that set and for the incredible sets that we had in Doctor Who. It was one of the great delights of the show. You know, we'd be working in one studio of a current episode and we'd see in the next studio Michael would be in and out, work with his crew, working on something else, and you would walk in and suddenly find yourself, you know, on frozen River Thames or in a Viking settlement or on one of many, many spaceships. And if you're lucky, Michael would appear and he'd be sort of, you know, he'd give you a tour of the set. And he knew everything about everything. He was an extraordinary man, incredibly intelligent, incredibly gifted.
Phenomenally detail-oriented.
Phenomenally detail-oriented and also full of great heart and vision. So it's a great, great loss. I should also say he designed one of the greatest British films ever made, which was With Nail and I.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, so he created, you may not know it, but it describes, it shows somewhere the culture of the British actors come from, which is grubby apartments, rather dirty and tobacco stained, Michael did all that.
Yeah, I didn't want to bring anything down on Sunday morning, but I wanted to make sure that we talked about Michael, because people like him are the reason that, you know, you have the cardboard and you know, aluminium foil, put together show that looks as good as Doctor Who does.
Yeah, because he knows where to spend the money.
Yes.
You know, to spend it on Westminster Bridge.
Ask a favor of you, can we get a round of applause for Michael?
Thank you. professional geek, and as a hobby, I make trinkets for people, and I've made you a couple. Both you two. And I'd like to be able to give them to you.
That would be lovely. Thank you so much. That's very sweet of you.
Was that the question? My trinkets.
I imagine so. Thank you. I'm down with that. I have one of those too.
You gotta catch
one of you, so. Exactly.
Serious hardware, man.
That's amazing.
It's fantastic. Oh, two.
That's two.
Oh, thank you so much. That's so kind of you.
That's
brilliant.
Incredible.
That was.
Thank you.
Amazing.
That was so kind.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This is just going to be a procession of gifts.
Yeah.
It's going very well for him so far. I'm going to say he's probably going to catch up.
Thank you very much. Something new with them, and Pearl had a whole thing going on which was totally hers and was not what I expected really, and that's fantastic because that keeps everything alive. Of course you've got to be as good as Pearl is in order for that to work. So I learned that she could do this character more brilliantly than anybody else. And that we could make something very special between us.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Okay, I just have a really quick question. I know you were in Paddington and you were just in the Pooh movie. Which one do you like better, Paddington or Pooh?
Oh, that's a war right there. Make the man choose. How could you? How dare you?
No, I think they're both lovely bears. Great to work with both of you.
Diplomatic as regards babies.
That was a tag team match
just there. Okay, you hold the phone, I'll ask the question. Now you hold the phone, I'll ask the question.
Okay, now you ask the question.
Oh, and I'll ask the question. So, I graduated from high school in 2019, and I was wondering if either of you would be in the position to provide a quote that I can use in the yearbook. Are you guys familiar with this concept?
No.
So,
so high school is later. What's your name?
Spencer.
Spencer. Spencer gets his photo in the yearbook, and they print a little quote underneath his name and photo in the yearbook, which can be anything, unless it's profane.
No.
Yeah. Even if it's profane.
Oh, I don't.
You go to a very progressive high school. Do you have a recommendation for a quote? Maybe a,
where there's tears, there's hope.
Boom. Oh. Oh.
That's just my own personal experience.
Spencer will fulfill his potential.
All right.
I know because I've seen him.
I would
love to have done with our modern technology to have done the web plan.
And
Ultra and all that stuff. Which they had absolutely no money. So when you see them now, it all looks a little bit tatty, but it's so imaginative. And I saw that as a kid. And I could, you know, those shows that they made were not meant to be watched again and again. It just went out once. And then people maybe 50 years later going, oh, look at that, you know, cardboard. But it was a great triumph of the imagination, because as a kid, those creatures existed in my head and grew and were made. So I would have loved to have done a return to the wet planet, but with new technology.
How about you, Miss?
I feel like the Weeping Angels.
This is proceeding to America.
So, how did it feel going from the role of the father in the Pompeii episode to the doctor himself?
Mm-hmm. Oh. No question.
Amazing, but I didn't. They didn't happen one after the other. I did that and thought that was going to be my only involvement with Doctor Who, was doing that role, which was great. And I went down and did it, and David Tennant was absolutely amazing to me, and great to be alone, and showed me the TARDIS, and it was all down in Cardiff and all that. And I thought, oh, that's a great gig, and I love Doctor Who, and thanks very much. But then they asked me to be in Torchwood, which was another bit of a Doctor Who. That as well. And then when they asked me to be Doctor Who, it was just it just made me laugh. You must be joking, really, basically, I thought. But they wanted me, so it was great. Thank you. Well, there are lots of great speeches, and so I don't like to say I have a favorite anything. But the speech that keeps coming back is the speech from Listen, about fear being a superpower, because I've met a lot of people who use that speech in circumstances that can often be quite that are tragic or difficult, or people who have been ill and have had to go through very difficult procedures. And they have used that speech to help them prepare. So it's delightful to be involved with something that has that part. But all of them, I mean, this icon's speech was amazing. I mean, it was like pages and pages long. And when we did it, and it went on all day, but when I first did it, there was a round of applause. And you don't normally get a round of applause. I thought, there must be somebody new here. and it was the American ambassador. But it just so happened that the American ambassador was touring because of the previous American ambassador. He didn't spend all his time in London. He spent his time traveling around the UK, trying to understand the UK, going to meet people, trying to see businesses, trying to see factories, trying to understand what people's lives what were like in the UK and how America's relationship with that would work. And on one of his travels, he came to Cardiff and they invited him to the studio. And so it was great that he and his team saw that speech and they applauded, which was nice.
On that same theme, every doctor gets one last speech going into regeneration. What was preparing for that like for you? Was the gravity of, you know, this is the last scene, was that intimidating or overwhelming for you?
Yes, it's a bit intimidating, but I just have still wants a speech like any other speech and just try and learn it. They probably just try and learn the words properly and then see what happens. But as a speech, it had been, I think, bubbling for a while with Stephen. I thought it was a beautiful speech. It was full of a lot of things that he and I were both very keen on. And one of the things was actually something that had happened in a situation like this, where someone in the audience at Q&A had asked me what the doctor's real name was. And I, sitting here, had said, you know, you wouldn't be able to pronounce it. But you might be able to hear it, because it's not what, so it's a frequency which can only be understood, you know, if the stars are in the right place. And so Stephen took that and improved it and put it to speech.
Wonderful question. What's your name?
I'm Paige.
Paige?
Yes.
What's your name? Paige, everybody.
I did the show at a time when we had some money. The other actors did it at a time when there was little money, and they would often have to work with things that were not great. But never for a moment did you ever see that in their eyes. Never for a moment did you ever not think that they were really on that planet, or really on the TARDIS, or really dealing with that monster. And I thought, that's real acting. Yeah. So they're all great. Who's your favorite?
The 11th.
My question is, if you could, for Pearl, it's the big enough for Peter as a doctor, if you could incorporate one part of a different one of you into your character, what part, like, if you could pick, like, for Peter, what part or outfit of their personality did you want, would you put in your character, if you could have chosen that?
What, you mean what part of Bill's personality would?
No, like any of them, any of the doctors. For you, we need the doctors, what part of their personality or what?
Okay, like what kind of quality of any of the doctors?
And then you, for you, for the companions.
For me, for the companions.
So much to choose from.
Good question. There is a lot to choose from, isn't there?
I'd like to have David Tennant's hair.
And then what do you think about the female doctor, the new, being that it's a new female?
I think she's going to be amazing. I think she's going to be fantastic. I mean, Jodie, she's
girl such a power!
Exactly, yes, girl power! Thank you.
Hello.
Hello.
My father watched it. One thing I noticed that's very different about your character is you weren't the fourth wall. Many of your episodes seem like you were speaking directly to the audience, not necessarily to any companion in Silent Tardis. How did that come about? Was that something you intentionally did? Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, I never deliberately, if ever I looked at the camera, spoke, it was because it was in the script. So it was my idea to do that. But I liked it. I think it's a really good idea. And I think the idea that the doctor is communicating directly with the audience is good, because I think he is. I think people have a very strong relationship with that character and feel that he is talking to them. But as a stylistic thing, I think it's good, but you've got to use it sparingly. But also it's just, you know, it's part of the mechanics of the show. Is the Doctor's often on his own in the TARDIS, so he has to talk a lot. You know, mind you, I talk to myself all the time. So it's quite natural for me to do that. But no, I like, it's sort of sharing a joke as well. It's sometimes, you know, it's almost winking at the audience.
Well, thank you very much for a great ride for the years that you were the doctor.
We've got about 10 minutes left. I think we can rapid fire through a bunch of them. Do you think we can do this,
yeah,
guys?
Okay, I have two questions. One, what's your favorite Doctor Who? Doctor Who villain. For any reason, design, how they are, what they do.
And the second question?
Second question is, what was your favorite, like, blooper behind the scenes moment?
Okay, favorite villain, favorite creature?
Dalek Missy Master Davos. And there are no bloopers because I was always very disappointed.
Mine definitely isn't the Mondasian Cybermen. Favorite blooper moment, I think, was in episode 2 when one of our supporting artists fell asleep during the really long scene that we were filming inside this big room. And we were all so quiet. We just said this little. We're lying on the floor for about 3 hours. It's obviously very comfortable. That was fun, so broke the day up a little bit.
I'm from Alpena, Florida. I'm sure you're enjoying this fall weather we're having. But my question is for you, Peter and Pearl. How does it feel to be part of such an iconic show that goes on for the generations? I mean, obviously, Peter, you were a Doctor Who fan many, many years ago when it started. But I mean, I can about, you know, you were the doctor for an important part of my life, like when I started high school, and you regenerated right when I started college. And so, honestly, looking back at certain parts of my life, I can remember who the doctor was and how they grew as I grew. And I think that's just a really cool thing, and I wondered if you experienced that as well growing up in the show.
Yeah. No, it's wonderful. It's very exciting. It's a privilege, really. You don't realize when you do any job that it has this kind of response, it makes this kind of connection to people all across the world, all over the world. If you think about that too much, it gets a little bit scary. Mm-hmm. So you mustn't think about, you know, the size of it. I just feel very, very blessed to have had a go at it and to get to meet guys like you in this situation.
Yeah, I completely agree. I mean, I don't think I'd really quite understood the magnitude of the show before joining it, which I think was kind of a blessing in disguise, because I think if I had known, it would have been quite daunting, you know, that it means so much to so many people. But getting to come to a place like this and meet you guys, you know, as you say, all over the world is phenomenal. And I feel like even though we left the show, it doesn't feel like it's ever left us, which is amazing. It's such a privilege.
It is amazing. Thank you guys for coming down here, and you're adorable, Pearl, by the way.
Hello.
Hello.
My question's for Peter. Sorry.
Sorry. Go for it.
I read someone in sixth doctor. He wanted an all black suit, and he ended up with a rainbow puking all over him. Did you get the suit that you wanted, or did you want a different outfit?
I pretty much did. I mean, I just always wanted to be, you know, to me, the doctor, my doctor was really about being wearing dark clothes and being sort of very stark and black and white. Because that's kind of how I remember, because we have black and white television, I guess. and that's sort of what I wanted. So yes, I did get that, but there's an increasing sort of daily pressure to kind of put on some colorful, you know, someone actually did say to me, wouldn't a scarf be a good idea? I thought, well, that's what's been done before. So yeah, I think I did get what I wanted, but it was, it's hard to hang on to, everybody keeps wanting to make a new action figure that's got more colorful things that you can stick onto it. Or I don't care about that.
All right, thank you.
Whoa.
It's
a weeping angel. Oh, amazing. You look amazing.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
Fantastic.
My question is, who is Clara, really?
I thought it was you, mate.
What would you say that she meant to you as a scene partner, as a character?
Well, you have to go back to her original story and see that she saved the Doctor in all of his...
Yes, several times, but who is she?
Was it to me?
Yeah.
You mean personally? Or the doctor?
Like, to the doctor.
She's the person that saved his life. He wouldn't exist if she had not taken the action she took. And so, in doing so, she transformed herself out of the corporeal existence to which we are all stuck into a cosmic dimension that has not yet been fully resolved.
Let's see, my friend. We met yesterday. You did exactly as I asked. You came to the Q&A. I'm gonna come over here and make this a little easier. Why don't you come up to the front for us? Here, stick that on the mic stand. Come up here. Come up here.
Hey, how you doing?
Hello. What's your name, sir?
My name is Philip.
Philip.
Philip, what do you have for us?
As the doctor, if you just put
So would you have some what?
So if you were touched by a weeping angel,
yeah.
And what dimension would you be teleported to, and how would you get back to the TARDIS?
Oh, man, I'm exhausted after the last.
Oh gosh. What dimension would I don't know. What dimension would you be teleported to, and how would you get back to the TARDIS? I don't know. But
is there a setting that you didn't go to in the series that you wish that you had? Maybe a particular time?
I'd quite like to go to Shakespeare's Globe and see a live play at that time when there's sort of, you know, there were like 5 hours long and there were breaks in between and
no
people
women.
Walking around drinking like mead that was probably like really warm and disgusting. It smelled quite horrible. Yeah, I think it was quite a gross time and everyone's really glamorized it. So I think I'd like to experience that and hopefully I'd get back to TARDIS as quick as possible.
I think it'd be transported to a dimension of stone, which is one that no one has been in yet. And so the understanding of how you could exist inside that matter would be fascinating. So and how you could live and breathe and move and be an organism while still being composed of those elements. Would be a fun thing to discuss. So I think that's where you would be. But how you would get back to the TARDIS, you'd just use your sonic screwdriver.
Thank you, Paul. Let's hear it from Philip, everyone. Now, the good news and bad news, sadly, the bad news is that we've run out of time. But we haven't really run out of time because you're here the rest of the day, yes? Everyone can come up to the exhibit hall to see you. I have one little thing to wrap us up. You've done a bunch of these conventions at this point. You've run into so many fans who are so generous with their love and how much your work has meant to them. And I wonder if there are memories that stand out to you, whether just across the board, the kind of affection and love that you get from the fans, or just particular interactions that maybe have surprised you, taken you aback, in terms of how much the show means to people that come up to you with all manner of things to sign, all manner of things to say, all manner of wonderful free things that they raise at the beginning of a panel, anything like that that really stands out for you?
Yeah, for me, I think I was in Berlin a little while ago, and a young woman came up to me. I think she was about 18. She was Malaysian origin, but lived in Berlin for a couple of years. And she came up to me, she was quite emotional, she was quite nervous to talk to me initially, but once we sort of had a little chat and sort of calmed her down a bit, she told me that essentially without me she wouldn't have been able to come out to her family. So, that's happened a couple of times since, but it still makes me emotional like thinking about it now. I think that's an amazing gift, and I didn't anticipate that would ever happen, so I think that's wonderful.
Sometimes people share things with you, experiences that they've had that are quite profound, and so it would be inappropriate of me to detail those, but I certainly have met many people who have had more than their fair share of troubles, and somehow this little show, which started like over 50 years ago, you know, touches them. Somehow this show has helped them. Somehow this show pulls them through. And that's just a great privilege to be associated with it. And also for them to share that with us. Because it's, you know, it's not me or Carol or Chris or David or any of us individually who have made this special thing. It's the show. The show has a power to help people. And that's a great thing. Particularly with the sorry state that the world is in at the moment.
Well, it's a really great thing that you make yourself available.